My father was a roofer. The roofs in New Orleans were put on with slates. It was a skilled job. Anybody can't put on a slate. So he was a skilled roofer, and he was a union man. And he said, if you go to work and there's a union, join it, no matter what kind it is. Any union is better than none, and if there isn't one, then organize one. And I carried that out. I've helped organize unions.
There once was a union maid. She never was afraid of goons and ginks and company finks and the deputy sheriff who made the raid. She went to the union hall when a meeting it was called, and when the legion boys come around, she always stood her ground.
Oh, you can't scare me, I'm sticking to the union. I'm sticking to the union. I'm sticking to the union. Oh, you can't scare me, I'm sticking to the union. I'm sticking to the union till the day I die.
This union maid was wise to the tricks of company spies. She couldn't be fooled by a company stool. She'd always organize the guys. She'd always get her way when she struck for better pay. She'd show her card to the National Guard, and this is what she'd say.
Oh, you can't scare me. I'm sticking to the union. I'm sticking to the union. I'm sticking to the union. Oh, you can't scare me. I'm sticking to the union. I'm sticking to the union till the day I die.
As a child, I was brought up on a farm with my older sister, younger sister and brother, and it was a farm in Michigan. My folks were rather poor. We were growing healthy kids, and my father used to say, well, if you don't work, you just don't eat. And so we said, well, we don't hear that from our friends. And where do you get that idea? He says, well, that's an old socialist tradition.
My father's mother was a very unusual young woman, apparently. The usual rule was when a young man got married and he brought his bride home, she had to get up early the next morning and make breakfast for the entire household to show that she was worthy of being a part of that family. So she deliberately stayed in bed. So she waited until she figured everybody else was up and was down in the kitchen waiting for breakfast. And she looked at them and she says, I want to make it clear right here and now that I am not going to be a servant here. I am not going to come here and try to show you my worth as to what a good cook I am, what a good housekeeper I am, all of those things. I am not going to do that. But I'll tell you what I will do. I'll go out and work with the men. I'll do the plowing, and I challenge any male member of this household to outdo me when it comes to work. And I've often said, gee, I hope I've inherited some of my grandmother's fighting spirit.
Was your father involved in the black movement?
Yes, he was a Garveyite. Marcus Garvey was a black man, and he started a movement called the Universal Negro Improvement Association. It was all blacks. They didn't let any whites into the movement. And I remember my father and mother, my brothers and my grandmother, every Sunday night in the Longshoremen's Hall in New Orleans, there was a big mass rally, and all of the blacks came to this rally, and they would come with music. There would be a band playing, and it was such a prideful thing to walk in here, you know, to this music, and you're going in to listen to these. And I remember there was one young woman who used to speak every Sunday. My father would say, don't you go to sleep. I want you to listen to what she's saying, because I want you to be like her. When you grow up, you have to be a speaker and go to rallies, and I had to sit there and listen to what she was saying. Did you hear what she said when she got home? And I would listen, and I would know what she said. And we used to march in the parades, and we used to have our big buttons on, you know, the Universal Negro Improvement Association. And it was a great movement, and it taught, if nothing else, black pride.
In the late 20s, we all left home, looking for a new life in the big city, Chicago.
Come on, baby, do you wanna go? Back, baby, and I walk on through the front door, singing, come on, baby, do you wanna go?
Beginning of the Big Depression when we hit Chicago, jobs were hard to come by, and the employers took advantage of it. Working conditions were just awful. Long hours, 12 to 14 a day, exhausting speed, low pay, but you needed to eat, so people took whatever little work they could get.
Thanks. Come on.
Around, the economy seemed to be collapsing. But President Hoover told us that prosperity was just around the corner.
Sweet home Chicago.
When you first got to Chicago, what did you think of it?
I was just, you know, it's like another world, you know. I can imagine what people feel like when they go to the moon. That's the way I felt, you know. Here I was brought up in a small, you know, village and had been to Kalamazoo, but never anything this large. It was rather overwhelming, you know. Really very much impressed in one way, but scratched the sidewalk to see if the grass would grow, you know, that kind of story you read about.
Did you go to work right away?
I tried to get a job. Herb was working in the stockyards and suggested I go there because I'd had experience and it paid more money, you know, than most places at that time. I guess it was 37 and a half cents an hour for women, 52 cents for men. It was a 15 cent hour differential.
I decided that I had to go to work. I came here to go to work. And I went, the nearest thing to where I lived was a laundry called Great Western Laundry. And all black women and poor whites worked in this laundry. And I decided to go there to find a job. So I went one morning and the man hired everybody and then he called me up and he said, have you ever had a job before in a laundry? I said, no. He said, well, we only hire an experienced help so you don't have to wait.
There was a bloom factory right close to where we lived. And we lived in the slums of the West Side. And my sister said, Katie, when you go to look for a job, I was 15, I think. Don't say, tell them you're 16. So I came to the Bloom Factory. The man said, how old are you? I said, 16. He said, you're too young. So I'm back home.
And he said, didn't I tell you yesterday we're not hiring anybody inexperienced? And I said, okay. So I turned around and walked out. The next morning, I came back again.
The next day, I went to a macaroni factory, and they said, how old are you? I said, I'm 17. You're too young.
And he looked at me, and I guess he said, well, maybe I'd better hire her for some. Anyway, that morning, he called me and he said, listen, I'm going to hire you, but if you don't do that work, I'll have no compunction all about firing you. I'll fire you just like that.
And anybody experienced? So I raised my hand. She said, where did you work? I said, I butchered on the farm. But you didn't work in any stockyard. No, I didn't, but I said I could do it. She said, okay. She looked me up and down. I said, you know, I was 17. You know, ruddy cheeks and so forth. And she says, well, I'll start tomorrow morning. And that's what happened. I went to work in the cookroom. I remember when Herb took me down, and I heard the cows going through the ramps. And so I said, oh, Herb, they can't be killing those pretty cows. You know, I was a farm gal milking cows. They're beautiful. And, you know, it just made me cry.
They put me to work in the department that made men's dispensaries and athletic supports, and I hadn't the least idea of what the stuff was.
You made them all day long, you didn't know what they were?
No, I had no idea what it was.
And, how'd you find out?
Huh?
How'd you find out?
Well, by talking with the women, and then, oh, I was so shocked to think that that's what I was working on, yeah.
And I was just working myself to death, just going so fast. And there were four women working on it. Two would shake out the sheets. I would take out the small pieces and shake them sheets. And, I mean, the towels and pillow slips. And the other woman would make out the tickets, you know, and bag up the things that did not have to go through the mangle.
Did the whites and blacks do different kinds of work?
The whites and blacks did different kinds of work and made different kinds of pay also.
How did you feel about the work at first?
Well, horrible. I'll tell you why. Because it was very monotonous. You stood up in one place and just stay there. And then you were told you can't talk, and you didn't talk. And, you know, I'm quite gregarious and a friendly sort of person, and I try to talk, and I say, shh, you want to keep your job? You don't talk. You just do your work.
What used to burn me up and what really used to hurt was that there were men, if they ruined something, not only that it was deducted from your pay, but the foreman, in the loudest voice possible, would cuss you out and call you the filthiest names. And I had seen grown men standing there and just sobbing, taking this insult because they had to have a job to feed their families. They took so much abuse that it was really, really hard.
At that time, people lost fingers and limbs and got no compensation because there wasn't workman's compensation, there wasn't an unemployment compensation. See, we talked about all these kind of things, and of course that was rather revolutionary in those days. This one woman was in the floor below. This is where they made the hot dogs. She would have to push the meat in and whatever, except when she pushed something and the machine was going, the chopper in, and just cut fingertips, you know. This friend of ours, she said something to the fact, well, how could they do this? They should have safety guards and all these, you know, because we talked about safety also. Well, and the people act to this incident, they were horrified, but they figured they couldn't do anything. Well, that night, a bunch of us got together, and we wrote out a leaflet on this and came out with certain demands and asked the women not to operate those machines until the company assured us that there would be safeguards. The whole plant heard about it, that they hear these bunch of women actually organized and stuck together, you know, and they went right up to the foreman and, you know, swore and said, you know, in Polish and in whatever, in English, you know, we know work. You fix a machine. Put safety guards on, you know, or something.
So they decided they were going to hire a boss. And they hired a white woman, and she was going, and I said, now, I don't know how we can work here. You know, we've been here 2 years, 3 years, and if they have to have a forelady, then it certainly seems to me that one of us should be the forelady. He's going to bring somebody in off the street who doesn't know the work here. We've been here doing it. So I think that we should just not, we all got together, then what should we do? I said, let's just stop working, and then when I comes up, we'll tell him that we don't want her to be forelady. We're not going to work under her. So we shut down the mangles, and this time when I came up the stairs, we didn't put them back on. So he walked up, and he was so surprised, and he looked like, what's going on here? He said, we're not working. We want to talk to you. Don't talk to me. Start the mangles up. Uh-uh, not this time. So he came over, and we got in around him, and we told him that we were not going to work with her as a forelady. Now, he could put her on the table and let her do some shakeout work. And the police came. And had it been like today, I suppose somebody would have been killed because we fought the police. I mean, we threw glasses at them and we threw bottles and they were trying to throw us out bodily and we were kicking and scraping. They finally got us out of the plant and then we didn't know what else to do.
It was already 1930 and when really things began to get very, very bad. So they called a meeting at which the the new superintendent announced that due to the economic situation, there will be a layoff of possibly 50% of the employees. And no mercy is to be shown to anyone. Does anybody have anything to say? And I say to myself, my gosh, Katie, you've got some responsibilities. After all, you're a radical. You can't let this thing go by and just keep your mouth shut and be a coward. So I lift my hand. I said, I protest. And everybody was just shocked. And he said, what do you have to say? I said, well, sir, I'm opposed to it. I said, now, what are some of these old women going to do who are inspectors and they've worked here for years and years? I said, where are they going to find another job? I said, even a young person can't find a job. And what do you think the young women are going to do? Do you want them to go down to 22nd and Wabash because that used to be the red light district of the time? So I wrote an article to the Daily Worker telling about what they were going to do, and I asked them to send me, I think, about half a dozen or seven or eight copies, whatever it was, and I got them, and I set the thing out. So I cut out the articles, and I bought some thumbtacks, and as I went from one place to another, I would stick this article that I had written. I also put one up in my own department. By the time I got back from other departments, when I came to my own department, it was bellowing. Somebody had shut off the machinery. The electric switch was at the end, you know. And one of the women was standing up on a table. Nobody was working. And one woman was up there reading the article. Listen to this! Look! Look what it is! It was printed in the newspaper, and it's about us! Somebody cares. Isn't that wonderful? Just look at this. Read it, you know. And she read the article. Hooray! Somebody's interested in us. Somebody cares what happens to us. And then the poor lady came running. She said, everybody get back to your place.
Everybody
hurry
up. She had that
particular kind of an accent. She said, Catherine, we have a feeling that you're very unhappy here. And we think it's best that we sever all connections. Here's your pay.
So you were fired?
So I was fired.
Did the other women try to get your job back?
No. When I called the girls, they said, look, what's the use of us speaking up? We'll only end up like you. We'll end up without a job. At that time, there was no union to join or anything. So I said, no, that's quite all right. I said, don't worry about me. I'll be all right.
Do you think if you've been more experienced, if you know some of the things that maybe you learned later, that maybe something more might have come of that?
Well, we would have organized that place. That was the beginning, would have been the beginning of a laundry workers union. Because I'm sure that's the first sit-down strike that was ever held in this United States, and nobody ever knew anything about it.
You think the people were ready for a union?
I'm sure they were. They were ready if they said, we're not going to work under this forelady. They had to be ready.
A few years later, I received a telephone call from the young woman who was my closest friend. And she said, Katie, guess what? She says, we've made it up to you, kiddo. We've finally made it up. She says, we've joined the union and we're out on strike and I'm the ticket captain. Now, how do you like that?
You gotta go down.
Thank you.
march, and we'll win that one big union by and by.
So we start getting out a paper called A Yards Worker. And in this, we would talk about conditions in different departments. And wherever people worked, we made contacts with people who worked in other plants. We tried to find out where people worked in Robertson Oak and Swift's or Wilson's, et cetera. And we'd talk about these conditions. And then we'd try to sneak these papers into the washrooms and wherever anyone could not get.
We actually had to sneak around.
Oh, not only from our bosom, because there was inspection going in and out, you see. You were actually inspected.
And you had to sign a yellow dog contract, which says, as long I pledge that I am not a union member, and as long as I am an employee of this company, I will not join a union.
They hired stew pigeons who came in to try to disrupt and break up the union. You know, one thing after another, and not only that, when our first big meeting that we had, the Seattle rally, they had thugs come in with guns and try to threaten and scare us. You know, and they did. They scared off some women. You know, women did come around. And, mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. But I was so, didn't bother, you know, I was scared, but I went anyway, you know. I was getting together with these other people, young folk. By the way, they're all young. And saying, well, here the CIO is taking the organizing and the sit-down in Flint. The steel workers are organizing. The automobile workers are. We want to organize, too. We got out a whole bunch of leaflets and circulated them all over the stockyards and said we were having this meeting, this first meeting in school hall. Tremendous turnout. We didn't have room to put the people in.
How many people came?
Hundreds and hundreds, I don't know. Maybe 500, 400, I don't know how big the hall was. But it was the most inspiring thing, just great. We had cards, we had Packing House Workers Organizing Committee cards. You know, I pledged to become a member of the union, so we signed up people.
At this time, did you see yourself as a radical or as a...
Oh, sure. Sure, because I wasn't about to do housework or anything else. Because now I was convinced I became a dedicated radical. You know, working with these friends whom I liked and respected very much. It made a lot of sense, you know.
Do you think very many of the people who were involved then in organizing the early CIO were also socialists?
Most of them were, I think. Most were dedicated or had or sympathies in that direction.
What would a socialist society mean to working people?
Well, basically, a socialist society would mean that the means of production would be owned by them and that the fruits of their labor would be divided on a more equitable basis than it was. There wouldn't be this tremendous disparity, that there wouldn't be hunger, that there wouldn't be hovels for some people and palaces for others, that there wouldn't be... different scales of education for children, mm-hmm. that there wouldn't be war, hopefully, you know.
I sat in on the meeting. They were just having an organizing drive, and everybody was getting up saying, well, I didn't get anybody signed up today because, you know, they would say, well, the union isn't any good, and when you get a union, you're going to have to pay union dues out of your money. If you don't have a union, you don't have to pay any union dues. And they talked, and I kept getting so disgusted. Here are these people trying to sell the union, and they aren't saying anything but what the workers are telling them. They're not telling the workers anything. So I held up my hand, and this guy recognized me. I took the floor, and I said, you know, at the rate you're going and what I'm hearing here tonight, you just ain't never going to get a union in this shop. If these people here are the ones that are trying to get the people to sign the cards and join, they just are not, because they're not selling union. They are letting the workers sell their no union. Why don't you, nobody has said, now what is the union going to do for the workers when it gets in there? What are you going to do? It said, well, we're going to fight for more wages, better working conditions. We're going to fight, and they had grievances about something in the washroom. We're going to fight to straighten all that out. I said, did you tell them that? He said, of course. I said, why don't they tell the workers that? And I was really elected steward that night,
And I think I signed up about five members that very first night. Look, I mean, you're not working on this ascending line if you don't join the union, sister. Please, let's get together.
We shall not, we shall not be moved. We shall not be moved, just like a tree that's standing by the water. We shall not be moved.
The union is behind us.
We shall not be moved.
The union is behind us.
We shall not be moved, just like a tree that's standing by the water. We shall not be moved. We shall not, we shall not be moved.
By the early 40s, the CIO had grown from a small number of organizing committees to a powerful force of several million. Contracts were won in steel and auto and maritime, but it didn't come easy. The whole idea of a militant labor force scared big business. They fought back in every way.
We shall not be moved, just like a tree that's standing by the water. We shall not be moved. We shall not be moved.
How long did it take you after that first meeting to get the majority of the workers signed up?
Long, long time. In fact, you know, our people were fired for trying to organize. People lost their jobs. Some never got their jobs back. The first plant that went CIO was actually where there was election was Armors. And we called all kinds of meetings, departmental meetings, union meetings, inside and outside, on different issues. We got out the Armors. We got out an Armor Flashes mimeograph bulletin. After work, we'd go in there in the union hall and we'd learn to run the mimeograph machines, and type, you know, everything. The women did a shit work then as they did now, you know, the old stuff.
There was a lot of absenteeism among the women, you know, and they had this business where they would take your regular card out of the rack when you came back to work, and they would put in another card. Then you had to take this card out and write your excuse on it and then take it to the foreman and give it to him. Then he would, you know, this was... But we said these women are working 7 days. We work 7 days a week. You know, it was during the war. And they don't, their work doesn't end when they leave here. They had to go home and wash. And well, you know what a woman does when she gets off from the job. And working 7 days a week, they don't have a minute. And we defy you to make those women sign those cards when they come in here. So we told all the women, you just put on the cards, just tired. You're just tired. That's all excuse you need. When you're working 7 days a week and then working 24 hours a day, really, because you went home and you did, then you're just tired. And so everybody started putting on a card, just tired. And they took those cards away.
Those poor women would work all day, then they'd come home and then have to take care of the house. Now, the union was a man's job. I mean, this is the way it was looked upon. And the few of us who were active in the union were not married, didn't have families, you know. There were very few women who were actually married and had children who were active in the union. Very few. You only had so many hours in the day?
Well, there was the beginning of the fight for child care. That the man would not, he might not see this as a special need, you know? Because he might still be thinking that the woman, she can take care of those children when she comes home, you know?
There was a real sexist attitude then. By society in general and by the radicals themselves. Well, I think that it was sort of preordained, in quotes, you know, that the men would have all the leading jobs and leading roles, and this is what happened. And the few women who aspired to be leaders, if you want to put it that way, didn't come by it easy. They had to take a lot of gaff.
For a short time, I had a district position in Chicago, but I wasn't allowed in the inner circle, you see,
because I was too much of a proletarian or outspoken or whatever it was. And so I had a corner of a desk. Well, the top officials would go out and have lunch together. And they never invited me. I was just a membership secretary, come to think of it. And so when it was time for me to go to lunch, I would go to lunch with the stenographers. And one day, the district organizer called me in and he said, "Catherine, it's very unbecoming for a person who is a district functionary, to go and have lunch with stenographers." I said to myself, "Go to hell. I'll eat with the stenographers. What is this, a workers' movement or what is it?"
And we have to work side by side with the men. I'm not saying that they have no place. They do, you know, and we have to, but we have to struggle sometimes against them because they don't recognize our worth, and sometimes there is jealousy. You know, this woman, you can't do this, you can't, and it's proven that we can do anything at all.
The most exciting meetings were those that were called at the shop gates, you know, and on any particular issue, union guys would show up with loud speaking systems. You walk out of your department with all, you know, your white, dirty white, bloody white, or whatever, you know, you were wearing uniforms, and the workers would come out and there would just a surge of faces and workers, you know, black, white, men, women. That's when the women really got to know about the union also, you know, and the speakers who would speak, and it would be a half hour lunchtime. It never was just a half hour lunchtime. When we got powerful enough, we took an hour or more.
And the company didn't say anything.
They couldn't.
In what ways did workers show their strength?
That's one way, right there. On an issue like that, or if something came up during contract time, et cetera, they did that. Or if something happened in a department, they just pulled the chain and stop it. They had stoppages right and left all over the place. And if the men on the kill floor pulled it, the chain, the whole damn place would close up.
Were they the first ones to stop?
There were many times. They were the most militant, the most radical. They knew they had power. You know, they really did. Because once they stopped the killing of the animal, you know, that's the first step, the whole shebang would close up. And it did.
Didn't you say those people were mostly black people? Black
mostly men? Black, right. The hardest jobs.
I didn't give a kitty what happened to the white workers. All I was interested in was organized black workers. Now, you could have taken all the white workers out and shot them. They've been all right with me, as long as you didn't bother the black workers. Somebody comes dashing back in my department one night and says to me, "You know, they're going to fire that woman up there." And she was on the shop committee. I said, "For what?" And she said, "She's out there fighting to get a black man in the tool room." I said, "Oh, come on, she's not fighting." You know, I didn't believe that. Why should she bother about whether a black man gets in the tool room or not? So the workers in the shop were angry with her in the tool and down because they said that they would not work in that department if they brought a black guy in there. Mm-hmm. So then all of the union officials get together and we decide that that's all right. If they don't want to work, then let them go. They can just, you know, get out. We didn't say it like that. We said it a little stronger. And
how did you say it?
We said they can get the hell out. I mean, we'll hire this black guy. We can go down on the next corner and hire as many workers as we need in here. So we went back and we told them, if you don't want to work with the guy, then leave. Well, they finally hired the guy and nobody left. They did not quit. And about 3 months later, the guy was still in the tool shop.
Did mm-hmm. white workers at the beginning find it difficult to accept black workers as equals?
There was always this tremendous discrimination where they lived, right, but not within the union, because they worked together, you know, they worked alongside. There were black workers who knew Polish, for instance. There was one guy, Hackney, who became a union organizer, and I'll never forget, he went to a meeting, spoke before a department of women, and started speaking Polish. Well, they're so impressive, and, you know, all these women joined the union.
It sounds like your attitude, though, toward white people changed.
Somewhat changed. I learned that you can't go anyplace unless you go to GABA. And that it was this one woman who was out here fighting for this black man to get in this tool room, I'd never heard and never believed that such a thing could happen. And I found out that people working together and fighting together for the same thing is the only way you're going to get anything.
But there were other things to be fought for besides organizing of labor unions. Millions of working people couldn't find jobs at all, and they needed to organize to protect themselves, too. So I helped to organize an unemployed council in Chicago on the Near West Side. One thing it was necessary to do was to fight evictions. Between 1932 and 1935, over 20,000 families in Chicago were put out on the streets with no place to go. And there was an eviction on 13th Street. And the people had called the South Side headquarters of the Unemployed Council. The police had arrested hundreds of people, truckload after truckload, trying to put this one family back in. By the time we got to the house where the evicted family was, the police came out from everywhere, you know? And one of them with a detective with a sawed-off shotgun got up on the top of the steps. And he was so big and so mean, and he says, the first son of a bitch that puts a foot on the steps, he said, is going to have their head shot right off. So I says, well now, Katie, is your is or is your ain't, you know? So I start marching up the steps. And as I started up the steps, the young white fellow goes along with me. And then suddenly I see a young Negro man and his wife on each side of us. So there were four of us going up the steps. And we walked right up to this detective with his sawed-off shotgun, went past him and came to the house and put our backs up against the door and then kicked the door with our heels. And then the whole number of police cars came, all the people came out of their houses, and I guess the man must have been the lieutenant of police or something in the area. And he said, damn it! He says, I'm tired of this. Let's call it quits, the hell with it. He said, I'll tell you what we're going to do. He says, I'm going to pass my hat. And the landlord was there. He says, I'm going to pass my hat for a collection. And every policeman here has to put the money in this hat. And then he passed the hat around and he called the landlord over. He says, here's your damn rent. And I don't want to hear another word. Now go ahead, open that door. Of course, the police weren't usually generous. Usually they were vicious, really vicious. Believe me, they fought us with police clubs, with blackjacks, with brass knuckles. They used dried banana stock because they showed less bruises. They used everything, but nothing daunted us. We fought back every inch of the way, and we were proud. We were fighting for justice. And we gave our lives to it, and gladly. So on the South Side, they killed three men.
These were black men?
Yes, three Negroes were.
The police killed three?
Yes, just shot them in the back as they were carrying in the furniture. And in those days, it wasn't like it is now when they, you know, when they killed the Black Panthers or anybody, you asked for an investigation. To us, it was class warfare. Because, you know, you fought them and they fought you, and that's it. So there was a funeral. Now, we started from 31st and State, and the nearest station is the Englewood Station at 63rd Street. State Street was crowded with thousands of people from wall to wall, from one end of State Street to the other.
Solidarity forever.
It was just a mass of people. Young people with a sheet went along the sidewalk, and then they would throw money into the sheet. the streetcars would just barely crawl along through the crowds. And that was the first time in my life that I have seen white people sobbing, really sobbing. There was such a strong feeling.
Solidarity forever. Solidarity forever. Solidarity forever. For the union makes us strong.
When the union's inspiration through the workers' blood shall run, there can be no power greater anywhere beneath the sun. Yet what force on earth is weaker than the feeble strength of one? But the union makes us strong.
Solidarity forever. Solidarity forever. Solidarity forever. For the union makes us strong.
In our hands is placed a power greater than their hoarded gold, greater than the might of Adam, magnified a thousandfold. We can bring to birth a new world from the ashes of the old, for the union makes us strong.
Solidarity forever, solidarity forever.
What do you think of the large industrial unions today?
Well, I think that they're quite a bit like the AFL was at that time. I think that they have not organized the unorganized. I think they've become conservative, very conservative. I think there's a tremendous amount of white-collar workers that should be organized, and this is not their major concern. I think the union should more also become involved in things outside of unions, the Nader-type things, you know, consumer, ecology, et cetera, to a greater degree, in a nutshell.
At what point do you think so the industrial unions began to become a little bit less responsive to the needs of the workers?
One of the radical unions were kicked out by the CIO, by Murray and that group. I think that's really when the mass organization of the unorganized went on a downhill and downgrade, and the unions became more conservative. And during the period of McCarthy, it had its tremendous repercussions. You know, there was an atrophy of creativity then.
Tell me, Kate, I wonder if you've ever regretted becoming a radical and having the life you did.
No. There have been times when some members of my family, especially in the recent years in my old age when I'm not in good health anymore, who said, you had to open your big mouth. Now, with your intelligence, you could have been something. But what are you now? You're nothing. That's what you are. You're just nothing. And I said, well, that's your way of looking at it, but it isn't my way. I have no regrets. I have no regrets whatsoever. I feel that there was purpose in my life, and there were very difficult times, but I'm proud to say that I survived them.
Wonder, you as an organizer back then, when you assessed the impact of unions in your own work, do you think that you did, do you feel good now about what you did, and what do you see that happened?
I feel very good. I know we made a lot of changes. I know that we trained a lot of people, you know, that, and some of that thinking is around, you know, and even though we have, you know, the George Beanies and the sellout artists and the guys ripping and running up and down in the White House, who have forgotten from whence they came, that there is a movement, you know, below.
When the women's movement first came along, what did you think about it?
Fabulous, great, you know. I said, I became part of it. Became part of a group through some young women who invited me and another friend of mine who are the oldsters in this group. Long time overdue. I participated to whatever degree I could. I thought it was just great.
In your work with the women's movement, did you find any difficulties personally?
Yes, I did. I have a certain impatience with some young women who I feel can't relate to working women. When you come from an area or an economic base where you have choices, you know, that you can't relate to people then who don't have, you know. And women who have to work for a living in the factories or in homes or in offices have a whole different concept of life and, you know, what is needed and required.
Mm-hmm. And it sounds like you felt to some degree that women in the women's movement who you knew didn't really understand that very well.
How could they? Maybe they hadn't lived long enough or had the same problems. They didn't have the same experiences, you know. On the other hand, I think that many of these women have done tremendous amount of revolutionary work. Opened up all sorts of ideas and concepts I didn't have.
I still believe in socialism, but I'll tell you something. I don't know if there is one single European country that has the kind of socialism that I would want. To me, socialism would mean that the greatest amount of say-so should be the people themselves. Let the people decide.
There's some tremendous potential in people, and labor people, and working people, and union people. And I think that they're very democratic, you know, and I think that there's a tremendous militancy that's sometimes below the surface and it'll rise and come up. I don't think the American working people are going to let down this country. And I don't think any fascist bastards are going to take over either.
Carry it on, carry it on, carry it on, oh, carry it on. There's a task that lies before us. We are strong when we're together. There's a word that's needin' saying. Carry it on, carry it on. Look with pride in where we've come from and with hope to where we're going. Every victory brings another. Carry it on, carry it on. All our mothers sang before us, all our children sing the chorus. Come on, sisters, lift your voices, carry it on, carry it on. Come from and with hope and where we're
The producers of Union Maids have made available a free brochure and study guide. Viewers can write to New Day Films, 215 Superior Avenue, Dayton, Ohio, 45406.